Well, it's been a day of hectic political developments, and it all started happening from about 6 p.m. this evening with the CBI summoning the Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal for questioning that will take place this Sunday. Arvind Kejriwal is to be questioned in connection with Delhi's alleged liquor scam. He is going to be with the CBI on the 16th of this month, as I mentioned. This is the latest setback for the Aam Aadmi Party. Remember, the CBI had arrested Manish Sisodia after nearly 8 hours of questioning on the 26th of February in connection with the same excise case. Broadly speaking, what is the alleged excise policy scam? It's been alleged that the excise policy of 2021-2022 of the Kejriwal government was used to extend financial favours to liquor licensees, and that this was taking place well after tenders had been awarded. The allegation as this is that this resulted in huge losses to the exchequer. So that's what this is broadly all about. Now, we are still waiting for a fresh reaction from Arvind Kejriwal after he was been summoned by the CBI. But approximately half an hour before news of this broke earlier this evening, these were some of the big political allegations that Kejriwal made against the centre.
राष्ट्र विरोधी ताकतें हैं जो इस देश को आगे नहीं बढ़ने देना चाहती। ऐसा कौन हो सकता है जो ये नहीं चाहता कि गरीबों के बच्चों को अच्छी शिक्षा मिले? ऐसा कौन हो सकता है जो ये नहीं चाहता कि दलितों के बच्चों को अच्छी शिक्षा मिले? अगर अच्छी शिक्षा मिलेगी तो बच्चे आगे बढ़ेंगे, बच्चे आगे बढ़ेंगे तो देश आगे बढ़ेगा, देश का विकास होगा, तरक्की होगी। वो कौन लोग हैं जो नहीं चाहते कि देश तरक्की करे? वो कौन लोग हैं जो नहीं चाहते कि देश के गरीब बच्चों को अच्छी शिक्षा मिले? उन सारे लोगों ने मिलकर मनीष सिसोदिया को जेल भेज दिया। ऐसे सारे लोगों ने मिलकर मनीष सिसोदिया को जेल भेज दिया जो नहीं चाहते कि गरीबों के बच्चों को, दलितों के बच्चों को अच्छी शिक्षा मिले। ये देश के दुश्मन है। जिन लोगों ने मनीष सिसोदिया को जेल भेजा है वो देश के दुश्मन है कि नहीं है? वो देश के दुश्मन है, वो नहीं चाहते कि देश तरक्की करे। और इतिहास गवाह है, इतिहास के अंदर कितने ऐसे उदाहरण है जिस व्यक्ति ने समाज के अंदर शिक्षा का प्रचार प्रसार करने की कोशिश करी, जब जब जिस भी व्यक्ति ने शिक्षा का प्रचार प्रसार करने की कोशिश करी, इतिहास में तानाशाह ने उसी को उठा के जेल के अंदर डाल दिया।
Well, my colleague Ankit has been tracking these developments very, very closely. He joins us now. Ankit, on what basis is the CBI calling Arvind Kejriwal now?
Well, it's very, very interesting what is happening in terms of the investigation. The same pattern was followed when Manish Sisodia was called. But Vishnu, there is one key difference between Arvind Kejriwal being called and Manish Sisodia, because Manish Sisodia was the minister in charge, deputy chief minister, who has his signature on this entire policy. Arvind Kejriwal, though being the chief minister of Delhi, doesn't hold any portfolio. So for the CBI, there will have to be some sort of statement or some trail that they have been, that they feel that Mr. Arvind Kejriwal needs to come out and answer. Now, what are those things? The CBI is investigating. The CBI says that one of the PAs of Manish Sisodia, Mr. Arvind, in his statement in front of a magistrate, which was recorded under Section 164, had said that both Satyendra Jain and Manish Sisodia had called him at Arvind Kejriwal's residence. He met both the ministers there, and that's where the whole idea of the liquor margin to the vendors going up from 6% to 12% was mooted. It was told to him that this has to be implemented. So the place of this meeting was the chief minister's residence. The other thing that possibly could be going against Mr. Kejriwal or could be a trigger for the CBI to call him for this investigation is the Enforcement Directorate's charge sheet, which doesn't name Arvind Kejriwal as an accused, but there is a mention of one accused, Vijay Nair, who was the Aam Aadmi Party functionary, of him having made one phone call to Mr. Arvind Kejriwal and acted as a conduit between the South lobby. And when Mr. Arvind Kejriwal was put on that call, he said, "Vijay is my boy. Whatever he says is directly coming from me." All these things at this moment are statements. They have to be backed by solid evidence. But when Arvind Kejriwal goes to the CBI on Sunday, it will become, more than the investigation, a big political optics point as well, Vishnu.
No, and that really is my next question. How is this going to play out politically? Because this is the lowest that we've seen in the fight between the BJP and the Aam Aadmi Party. No two ways about that. Kejriwal being called by the CBI. How is this going to play out politically?
Well, I think it was something that a lot of people were in some way expecting, because remember, the Arvind Kejriwal has also switched gears from not saying a word against the Prime Minister to continuously attacking the Prime Minister now, questioning his educational qualifications, going totally out and attacking the Prime Minister is something that we have seen a shift as far as Arvind Kejriwal's strategy is concerned post the Gujarat elections.
Yes.
Now, this also brings some sort of a sharp reaction from the BJP. We also know there are constant tussle between Arvind Kejriwal and the central government in form of the left-wing governor in the national capital. Politically, Arvind Kejriwal, who so far there is no corruption image which has stuck to him, but this is what possibly is going to take Arvind Kejriwal in that hole.
All right, Ankit, thanks very much. We'll leave it over there. We're going to quickly move on, talk a little bit about opposition unity. And Udhav Sena leader Sanjay Raut has welcomed the Congress and Nitish Kumar's opposition unity push. The veteran Maharashtra politician Sharad Pawar has met the Congress leader Rahul Gandhi and the Congress party chief Mallikarjun Kharge on Thursday evening, yesterday evening, amidst efforts by the country's splintered opposition to band together ahead of next year's national elections. The meeting comes a day after the Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar and his deputy Tejaswi Yadav met Mr. Kharge and Rahul Gandhi amidst talks of some opposition parties teaming up on a common platform to take on the BJP next year.
Congress party ne jo prayas aur pehel shuru ki hai ki sabhi vipaksh ke netaon se milna hai, unse baat karna hai. और 2024 में हम सब मिलकर चुनाव लड़ेंगे. ये बात हम शुरू से उद्धव ठाकरे साहब कहते आए हैं या और भी नेता करते आए हैं. कांग्रेस एक राष्ट्रीय पार्टी है. कांग्रेस पार्टी के अध्यक्ष खड़गे जी और कांग्रेस के नेता राहुल गांधी जी ने ये जो प्रयास शुरू किया है उसका हम स्वागत करते हैं.
Well, let's go across to NDTV's Himanshu, who joins us for more on this. Himanshu, there have been so many efforts now that one has lost count of efforts of opposition unity. One party tries to reach out to other parties. They talk about unity and then they have fights or issues with each other. How is this effort any different?
Well, I mean, that is a difficult question to answer now, because remember, only in Karnataka elections, for instance, D. Raja, who is the CPI General Secretary, he told me today that while Congress talks about opposition unity in Delhi, but in Karnataka, we wanted a seat-sharing agreement, both CPM and CPI, with the Congress, but the Congress showed no interest. So you have to also implement the ideas that you discuss in Delhi. That was the one important message that D. Raja gave. We also know that NCP has also decided to field candidates against Congress in Karnataka. So clearly there are contradictions in the opposition camp. For the moment, what is new is that there are three prominent leaders who have emerged as new power centers in the opposition camp. Mallikarjun Kharge, Sharad Pawar and Nitish Kumar. And these are three prominent leaders who now have a new outreach plan. Mr. K.C. Tyagi, the Principal General Secretary of JDU, has told NDTV today that in coming days, Nitish Kumar is planning to meet Mamata Banerjee, Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik, Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao and Samajwadi President Akhilesh Yadav. So clearly, they have a new outreach plan. They want to reach out. Only yesterday, I remember Sharad Pawar had told both Rahul Gandhi and Mallikarjun Kharge that you have to also reach out to difficult parties for you like Mamata Banerjee and Kejriwal. He had specifically mentioned Kejriwal. Now, I think the action that CBI is going to initiate against Kejriwal is going to bring more urgency to this effort to cobble up an opposition, a united front at the national level. But the question that you asked, the contradictions are deep. There are many states where opposition parties are up against each other, whether it is Samajwadi Party in UP against Congress, in West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee is against Congress, in Kerala, LDF and UDF, they fight elections against each other. So there are states where their opposition parties are against each other in terms of ideology, in terms of political contradiction. So I think there's a long road ahead for Nitish Kumar, Sharad Pawar and Mallikarjun Kharge to cobble up a national united front of opposition parties.
All right, thanks very much for sharing those details with us. We're going to move on to some other news. And the former BJP leader and former Karnataka Deputy Chief Minister Lakshman Sawadi has joined the Congress today. He'll be contesting from the Athani constituency from a Congress ticket days after the BJP dropped him as a candidate in Karnataka. A senior leader today decided to join the Congress after meeting with leaders who said it was their duty to take such great leaders on board. Lakshman Sawade quit the BJP on Wednesday, a day after the BJP announced its first lot of candidates for the May 10th Karnataka election.
Influential Lingayat leader Lakshman Sawade has joined the Congress 2 days after his name was not on the list of candidates released by the BJP for the May 10th assembly elections in Karnataka. Lakshman Sawade said his grouse was not just his immediate disappointment at being denied a ticket.
ಅವಾಗ ತೆಗೆದಾಗ ನನಗೆ ಅವಮಾನ ಆಗ್ಲಿಲ್ವಾ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನಾನೇನು ಕೇಳಿದ್ದ ಅದು ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗೋದಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಜರ್ನಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ನಿಮ್ಗೆಲ್ಲನೂ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುತ್ತಲ್ಲ ನಾನೇ ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಹೇಳ್ಬೇಕು
ಟಿಕೆಟ್ ಕೈ ತಪ್ಪಿಸ್ತಿರೋ ಅನಿಸ್ತಿದೆ
ಯಾರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನಾನು ವೈಯಕ್ತಿಕವಾಗಿ ಟೀಕೆ ಮಾಡೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಒಟ್ಟು ಭಾರತೀಯ ಜನತಾ ಪಕ್ಷದಿಂದ ನಾನು ವಂಚಿತನಾದೆ ವಂಚಿತನಾದಂತ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯವಾಗಿ
ಬೆಳಗಾವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ
The Congress claims many more from the BJP are keen to join them, but they are unable to accommodate.
We feel that he has been humiliated. It is our bound duty to take such great leaders to the Congress party. There are still so many leaders, about more than 9-10 sitting legislators who wanted to join us, but we are just looking, we don't have a space to accommodate them.
Chief Minister Basavaraj Bommai regrets losing Lakshman Sawade. Says the leader was safeguarding his own political future.
ಹೌದು ಅದು ಗೊತ್ತಿದೆ ಇದು ನೀವು ಮುನಕ್ ದೂಸಿಂದ ನೀವೇ ಬಿತ್ತರಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀರಿ ಸಭೆ ಮಾಡಿ ನಿರ್ಣಯ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಭಾಳ ದುಃಖ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ನಮಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಒಡನಾಟ ಇರುವಂಥವ್ರು ಒಂದೊಂದ್ಸತಿ ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಸನ್ನಿವೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಗ್ತವಿವೆಲ್ಲ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಅವ್ರ ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಭವಿಷ್ಯ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಡಿದೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ
In 2018, Mr. Sawade lost to Congress candidate Mahesh Kumthalli in Athani constituency. Mahesh Kumthalli had subsequently defected and is now the BJP candidate from Athani. In fact, Sawade will also now be contesting from Congress ticket from Athani constituency.
The BJP is hoping that the storm of discontentment will blow over and that they can remain in power while the Congress is cashing on in the rebellion. In Bengaluru with Kumar Shrija for NDTV.
Well, my colleague Veera Raghav, who's been tracking all of the developments in Karnataka closely, joins me now. Veera Raghav, will dissidence be a major factor against the BJP ahead of these elections?
It's not just about one leader, Vishnu, which is Lakshman Sawade. We're talking of a general perception that there is discontent within the ranks, and that's dangerous for a political party like the BJP in Karnataka, which has to win a close fight. I think it's reflective of the different camps that are in operation in the top level, and that there may not have been that unified charge in the state. Just a bit of statistics to put this in perspective. In the last assembly election, out of 30 assembly constituencies where the margin of victory was less than 5,000 votes, the BJP won only 8 and the Congress won 19 of it. So this kind of dissension and dissidence in a closely fought election could be very, very counterproductive.
Will the Congress and the JDS accommodate dissidents, I mean, going forward? I mean, is that part of their strategy going forward?
I think it's obvious the fact that they've accommodated Lakshman Sawade, they've kept about 50 seats open. The JDS is yet to come out with its list. They would be more than happy to accommodate dissidents where the dissidents are winnable candidates. You see, this is more about the winnability of the dissidents. There are some cases where dissidents have been denied tickets because they don't have the ability to win. For instance, if you take Lakshman Sawade's case, he lost the 2018 assembly elections, but it's expected that with the Congress vote, as well as with whatever he can bring along, he may be a potential strong candidate in that constituency because the winning candidate in 2018 has shifted sides. So I think they would carefully calibrate the ability of a candidate to win before accommodating a rebel.
Okay, we leave it there. Veera Raghav, thanks very much for joining us. We're going to move on now. The centre has denied sanction to prosecute 30 army personnel allegedly involved in a botched encounter in 2021. This was during an operation in Nagaland. The center says that these soldiers remain protected under the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. 14 soldiers were killed in this incident in the Tura region of Nagaland. And family members of those who were killed are asking one question: where's the justice?
These are the survivors and family members of those caught in the middle of an army operation in Nagaland, which went all wrong in December 2021. More than a year after the botched operation in which 13 Naga men were killed in a case of mistaken identity, these villagers lie shattered. The center has officially told the state government that the soldiers involved in the operation cannot be prosecuted. They remain protected by the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which allows armed forces to operate without fear of police arrest in disturbed areas which face insurgent threats.
আমি খালো কথা চাষটিতে কি দিয়া দিব ইন্ডিয়ান গ্রামের বেটো আমি খান তো ইন্ডিয়ান গ্রামে নয় নাকি ইন্ডিয়ান পাবলিক নয় নাকি আমি খান ইন্ডিয়ান সিটিজেন নয় নাকি আমি খান তো এইটো চাষটিতে কি দিয়া পাবো এইটোয়ে রখি আছে এইটো জি হইলে বি ইন্ডিয়ান গ্রামের বেটো দিব লাগে
আমি সরকার সে এই প্রশ্ন চাতা হুম আসপা কা ওজে সে আমারা জো বেনিফিশিয়াল উনকো জো দেনা उसको आप लोगों ने ब्लॉक किया है आसपा का बारे में तो आसपा किस चीज़ के लिए लागू किया है मैं ये जानना चाहता हूँ स्टेट गवर्नमेंट से भी पूछना चाहता हूँ और सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट से भी पूछना चाहता हूँ
The decision to not prosecute comes despite efforts by the police to push through with a proper investigation.
The special investigation team or the SIT of Nagaland police probed the incident and charged 30 army men of the special forces with murder, claiming that the victims were shot with an intention to kill.
The center's decision to prevent prosecution of the soldiers involved comes at a time when the controversial Armed Forces Special Powers Act is being progressively eased out of large parts of the Northeast. Earlier this month, the Home Minister said this was a reflection of the improved law and order situation in the region.
Mitro, ab sabha ke parighe mein bhi bahut badi kami aayi hai. Ek zamane mein अब सपा हटाना चाहिए यहाँ के लोग मांग करते थे कांग्रेस ने अपने चुनावी घोषणा पत्र में कहा था कि अब सपा हटा लीजिए हमने कहा था कि अब सपा नहीं हटाएंगे सेना और सशस्त्र बलों के लिए जरूरी कानून है परंतु हम ऐसी स्थिति रखेंगे कि अब सपा लगाना ही न पड़े और आज मैं बड़े आनंद और गर्व के साथ कह रहा हूं कि 70% नॉर्थ ईस्ट के अंदर से अब सपा को हटा लिया गया है
फॉर द फैमिलीज ऑफ दोज किल्ड इन द ऑपरेशन इन तिरुवोटिंग इन नागालैंड दिस विल कम एज नो कॉन्सोलेशन देयर लव्ड वंस डाइड फॉर नो फॉल्ट ऑफ देयर ओन विद रत्नदीप चौधरी उसामा शाह फॉर एनडीटीवी
Ambedkar statue in the country is now in Hyderabad, even as K. Chandrasekhar Rao wants to position the BRS, his party, as the tallest votary of scheduled caste rights and opportunities in India.
Buddham Saranam Gacchami.
India's tallest Ambedkar statue, 125 feet high, and standing on a 50-feet podium, opened in Hyderabad by Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao, who says his BRS party stands tallest in the country in implementing schemes for the welfare of scheduled caste population.
Ade kaakunda adbhutamainatvanti Bharat deshamlo kaadu prapanchamlo ekkada lenatvanti goppa karyakramam nijanga abhivruddhini sadinche karyakramam dalitala aarthika abhyunnatiki dohadapade karyakramam dalita bandhu kuda తెలంగాణ గవర్నమెంట్ తెచ్చిందని మనవి చేస్తా ఉన్నా అదేవిధంగా ప్రతి సంవత్సరం 25 లక్షల దళిత కుటుంబాలకు తెలంగాణ దళిత బంధు లాంటి దళిత బంధును అమలు చేస్తామని చెప్పి అన్ని రాష్ట్రాల వాళ్ళకు కూడా ఈ సదుపాయం అందుతుందని చెప్పి నేను మనవి చేస్తా ఉన్నా అందువల్ల ముందుకు వెళ్తాం అంబేద్కర్ గారు
The reason KCR is doing this is not just to appeal to the AC community here in Telangana but also pan India As we all know, he's been speaking about Ab Ki Baar, Kisan Sarkar. So farmers' issues is something that he hopes will have resonance across the country. And he is also talking about the Dalit issue with the Dalit Bandhu itself. In Telangana's Mancherial, Congress President Mallikarjun Kharge addressed a Bharat Satyagraha Yatra appealing to the same SC community.
The Congress is the one which got the Dalit or SC vote, and that is something that he will be appealing to at a time when in fact there is this move for opposition unity. And after the meeting of Mr. Kharge, Nitish Kumar and Tejaswi Yadav with Mr. Rahul Gandhi as well, what sources are telling us is that Mr. Kharge is expected to reach out to Mr. KCR as well. And considering that KCR, BRS and Congress are political opponents in Telangana, possibly no movement on that is possible till at least the assembly elections happen towards the year end.
The tallest Ambedkar statue in shiny bronze cost 146 crore rupees. It is just a stone's throw away from the new Telangana secretariat that has also been named after Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and will be opened on April 30th. In Hyderabad, with camera person Nagaraju, Uma Sudhir, NDTV.
All right. Well, there have been Bihu celebrations in Assam today, spectacular ones at that. More than 11,000 dancers and drummers at a single venue. These performers shattered a world record in the presence of the Prime Minister. And finally, it's been 20 years since we launched our channels, NDTV 24/7 and NDTV India. NDTV as a company has, of course, been much older, but it really was a red letter day for us when we launched our own channels. In fact, three of them, NDTV Profit, NDTV 24/7 and NDTV India. Here's a quick look back at that spectacular journey.
In April this year, we plan to launch two 24-hour news and current affairs channels. One in English and the other in Hindi. Hello, welcome to our midterm poll.
The Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court has reacted sharply to the NDTV expose.
Good evening, welcome to India Decides.
Namaskar, Indian Obje mein aapka swagat hai.
Future is clear.
Who forms the government?
Namaskar, Arakshan par vishesh mein aapka swagat.
Hello and welcome to We the People.
Namaskar, khabron mein main Kadam.
Good evening and welcome to Left, Right and Centre.
Namaskar, NDTV India mein aapka swagat hai.
Give you the bigger picture on the elections.
Namaskar, hot topic mein aapka swagat
hai. Bajit ne a lot of expectations.
Tez ki baat mein hazir hai pehli baar.
The news that matters, the news you need.